Awaken out of your dream of illusion and hear the divine broadcaster calling all souls. No sword avails against him, no spear, no dart, no shaft. He treats a harpoon like straw, a bronze lance is like rotten wood. Job 41, 26-27. Well, Job knew what he was talking about. In fact, this is a truth, that nothing can affect the spirit of God in man. When man has realized this truth, then his outer garments become invulnerable too. That is to say, nothing can harm him, even his body. It is known, and I have seen these things myself, by the masters in the Himalayas, where the body is subject to the spiritual control of the individual, and heat and cold makes no effect upon him. White heat, cold as ice, yes, 50 degrees below zero, in fact, has no effect upon them, while other people will be frozen to death. While at the same time, white hot iron has no effect upon the flesh. So you see, it is this power of the spirit when it is recognized. But this realization does not come to the individual who lives in separation. If you live in separation, it is impossible for the mind to free itself from the limitations that it has accepted, and not until the mind is free from limitations can the spirit manifest through that mind and produce its own power. And Job knew this. God is creative spirit, ever present and present everywhere and eternal now. This must first be comprehended before the mind can become a channel for the unlimited creative power to manifest through the individual. If I say to you, or you say to yourself, God is love, which you know is true, but if you are antagonistic, if you have separations between one and another, if you have certain beliefs that create separation from one mind and one individual and another, then you cannot say that God is love, because you do not know it is only an idea in your mind. Therefore you go, and then what do? You worship in church and you kneel down, and while all the time you are antagonistic to your brother. Now is your worship not utterly hypocrisy? Do you think then that God hears your prayers? The master said, when you have anything against your brother, go make it up with him, make it well with him, and then come God and pray. God only knows love and sincerity. God is not moved by any form of will of man. God is not moved by bribes. God is not moved by any belief. God is only moved and easily moved with love and sincerity. In him who is infinite must exist all life, consciousness, and intelligence. Truth is a name given to the science of the expression of life, consciousness, and intelligence. Therefore God knows no one, neither is he subject to time, space, or circumstances. When this is understood by the individual mind conceives the unlimited state of man. God being infinite, man must be the expression of the infinite God. In man the divine spirit manifests. Therefore man must share the resources of the divine spirit. Man must also live and move and have his being in the infinite, and must therefore share the creative power and potentialities of the infinite who created him in his image and likeness. What is the hindrances to the expression of this spirit? If one could do it, all can do it. It was this complete freedom, the unlimited state of the master's mind, of Jesus' mind, that enabled him to perform all those feats we read about. But we know that it can be done, for the simple reason, when we also clear away the hindrances in our mind, we find the Spirit of God manifest. But it is difficult for the individual who is caught up in limitation, in self, which is limitation, and the greatest limitation is the self. Then if everything moves around the self, and the self alone, then the self is limited completely. Of mine own self I can do nothing, it is the Spirit of the Father within me that doeth these things. Thus there can be only one Father of all, who is in all and through all and is all. Call no man your father on earth, for one is your Father who is in heaven. These words now have a true significance for us all. I can see the mind of the master, how he was trying to show his disciples the great and mighty truth that underlay his own power, and he showed definitely that if anyone would believe in him and him who sent him, if anyone believes in me and in him who sent me, they have eternal life now. Therefore, our true position in the universe is that of a son or daughter of God, made in his image and likeness. To this each and every one of us must cling, to make that complete harmony so that individually God can express his creative power through us. Separation is the great illusion that hinders this true expression. Separation then covers a multitude of sins, because anything that separates man from man and man from God, in the mind of man, is a sin. It is that which prevents man from giving true expression to the Father who is in him is a sin. And ignorance is the greatest sin, because ignorance enables the mind to become caught up in separation and limited in its own beliefs. You have already reached this stage now, every one of you, where you have cast these beliefs aside. You have seen that they are limitation. You have also seen that they are the beliefs of others, and if you accept them, beliefs of others, then you are limited. No inspiration can come from any other person. No inspiration can come from any human being. Inspiration can only come from the spirit within man. The Christ is the inspiration in all of us. Any other inspiration is a limitation. If inspiration comes from a belief, then you are limited. Inspiration can only come from wholeness, completeness, that is true inspiration. As his children, therefore, we are in reality pure spirit, not subject to ills which the mind of man thinks he is subject to. If the soul of man or woman is disturbed, it is because fear has entered the mind and the real truth is for the moment not realized. When you are caught up in fear, caught up in the self, caught up in possessiveness, caught up in any of these emotions, is the truth in you? No. Look into the mind of an individual that is caught up in these things and you will see that there is no truth in it, because it is for the time being caught up until such time as they are able to discern what they are doing, what they are thinking, and when this true discernment comes, there is freedom. Discerning just on the surface is of no value. That discernment must go deep down into the individual and therefore discern these things that are a hindrance to the true expression of the spirit or truth in man. Yet in pure spirit we live and move and have our being. Be ye perfect as your Father in heaven is perfect, is the saying of the Master who knew the life of God in mankind. Here's the great truth. Don't you see now the hindrance to this is in your own mind? If we could sweep away all separation, the belief in separations, the beliefs that cause separation, all limitations in the mind. These limitations that you are born with, limitations you gather as you grow. The fears that become dominant in your mind, the this and the that. Your mind is crammed full with limitations and there is no possibility of the truth manifesting in an individual that is so bound. Now let us ask ourselves this question, what is breath? Breath is life. The soul continues to breathe whether in the physical or out of it. The soul never ceases to breathe because the spirit is the life that animates it. It is not the body that breathes, it is the soul that breathes. When the soul leaves the body does not breathe at all. Life organizes the soul as the instrument for its expression, and the soul then organizes the body as its means of expression. But if you deny the infinite life in the body, you deny the infinite life in totality because of the fact, being infinite, this infinite life must be eternal and ever-present and present everywhere. To deny that infinite life in the body is to deny infinite life itself. If you then deny this infinite life in the body, you have limited yourselves and there is no limitation. The mind creates the limitation. Spirit has no limitation. God is creative spirit, ever-present and present everywhere and eternally now. And when we realize this truth, I am not saying that it is easy by any means, because you are caught up in limitation. If you are in a prison, you have got to break down the bars, the doors, and these things that make you prisoners, and you make yourselves the prisoner. So we see then that the food we eat is also spirit substance, because there can be nothing else, God being infinite in nature. Of this the consciousness must become aware, and aware of itself, aware of its oneness with infinity. That is why Jesus pronounced all food clean, and nothing that they would eat at any time could in any way harm them. My consciousness is the consciousness of the infinite spirit expressing itself through me. The consciousness or creativeness of God must express itself through the consciousness, the creativeness in man. When we are aware of this, that this is so, our whole being is subject unto this law of thought and action. That the infinite creative power is expressing itself through me. The consciousness or creativeness of God must express itself through the consciousness or creativeness of man. Therefore your whole mind, your circumstances, your body, is subject unto the law of thought and action. The creative thought of God in man. Man has been given free will to think, to create for himself. He learns dearly because he has allowed other people to do his thinking for him and not think for himself. Thinking for yourselves frees you. To accept another's thinking, I tell you, limits you and binds you. A teacher can only be a teacher when he directs you towards that which is within yourselves. A teacher can only be a teacher when he directs you how to free yourselves. A teacher can only be a teacher when he directs you to look into your own self and find there what is hindering the true expression of the Spirit of God. A true teacher is only a true teacher when he realizes this truth, that God and he are one. The Father and I are one. But I of myself am nothing. It is the Spirit of the Father within me that doeth these things. But a teacher that tells you how to think is a thief and a robber and is no teacher at all. Jesus never taught you how to think. He told you how to find that which is perfect in itself, within you, and all his words were directed to the Spirit of God in man. His parables, as we will see later on in this course, how beautiful they were placed, showing that as man began to think for himself, he could find the kingdom of heaven. The prophet says, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me," meaning that he was aware that the Spirit of God was actually working through him. His words may have been tinged by his own beliefs, thus inspiration is always according to his capability to receive, free from limited ideas or beliefs, free from opposites, free from prejudices, antagonisms, and separation. If you put God outside yourself, and you make him relative, do you think you can get inspiration through a mind like that? Do you think that on your knees and you pray to some God you think is outside? Why? Jesus made it plain you pray to something you do not know, but we pray to that which we do know. Therefore, our differing beliefs are a hindrance to the Spirit's true expression, and you have found out that by now, I hope to God. If it is our belief in the evils we think we are subject to, that is the cause of sickness, worry, and fear. Understanding the truth is the key to freedom. Ideas creates their opposites. We must be free from opposites. When I say health, the opposite ill health rises to combat it because the mind is full of opposites. When the consciousness is not aware of its source, even hope, peace, love create opposites in the mind that lives in separation. Therefore, if you say that God is love and you have separation in your mind, a belief in evil, then you know and you have a devil. That is the opposite to God. But God being infinite in nature and is all there is. And if God is, then the devil is not. It is a product of the mind of man. No matter whether a prophet invented it or any other person invented it, it is for you to think these things out for yourselves and find the truth about them. Now this science that eliminates opposites from the mind is understanding of the divine truth as Jesus taught it. When I claim all that God has, I make my claim, knowing that by doing so I am expressing his will in me. His creative mind is in action through me. But this is not so easy as it looks, because the mortal sense mind is concerned with the things of this world and not with the things of the Spirit. And when we begin to see the meaning of the Master's words was not to be caught up through the mortal sense but to understand this spiritual power and the power behind all things. And it is the things of the Spirit that we must understand, the power to think, the creative power within us. The Father and I are one. Discern the thoughts and everything else that hinders the true expression of the Almighty in man. All these things are of the Spirit, but to be caught up through the sense mind, in the conditions and circumstances around you, then you are living in separation and you are creating misery for yourselves and for others. It is the cause of all sorrow and conflict. We must discern the things of the outer with a deeper sense of our spiritual relation to Him, our Father in heaven, otherwise we can never be free. The question is, how can one be free from a problem that is disturbing? To understand and solve a problem, we must give our undivided attention to it. Both the outer and the inner mind must take part in the solving of it. But most of us try to solve it superficially with no knowledge of the inner reality that is capable of creative action in regard to it. If you then see the power of the Spirit, you see the creative action in regard to any problem that you have, you will dissolve it. It will pass from you because Spirit is capable of dissolving all things. I of myself can do nothing, it is the Spirit of the Father within me that doeth these things. Most of us are educated to the patriotic or national spirit, we are brought up to love our country in opposition to another. Therefore we regard ourselves superior to others and so on. This is implanted in our minds from infancy. We are proud of our inheritance or we may develop a feeling of inferiority in regard to it. This is the outer layer of the mind and we will see how stupid it is when we begin to realize the great significance of the inner reality, the real world in which we all live and have our being. But don't you see that the masses are caught up in this limitation because they have been grounded from infancy? Children have been educated according to certain beliefs. There is no other belief but that belief, and when they grow up their mind is confused. When the truth is shown to them or when they begin to think out the truth for themselves, there is a great difficulty at first. They are afraid, fear overcomes them. Is fear not a product of the self? God has no fear, therefore man should have no fear because he is made in his image and likeness. But that prison that he is barred and locked. All his life he has not been allowed to think for himself. In fact, he cannot think for himself. And a great many do not want to think for themselves, they are too damned lazy. What is necessary is to see the truth that is real, then the bars and windows will break down. But if you are too lazy to think for yourselves, then you still remain in your prison which rules you by beliefs and tradition. Now the naturalistic spirit feeds on vanity, the assertion that we are of this or that race feeds on our puffed up egos. And we are ready to kill to defend what we think is our race or tradition. Now, don't you see how stupid it is when there is but one life, one God manifesting in all and is all? Don't you see this stupid separation in the mind of man is causing all this trouble in the world? Not until such time as we begin to think and see those things can we discard them. By identifying ourselves with our self-importance, we hope to become greater, but we only become poorer. Remember, the nationalistic spirit is used for economic purposes, for fear and hatred to unite one section of people against another. When we become aware of this problem and its implications, we perceive its effects, or misery, starvation, destruction, confusion, controls, and limitations. Here is sound reasoning, my students, and the only sound reasoning. It is because you have not discerned these things that you are caught up in them. The denial of human unity breeds endless wars and brutalities, economic and social division and tyranny, sickness and misery. If we understand this with a thin layer of our outer consciousness only, we will still be caught up in tradition, opinion, fear, or conquest. If you only discern these things with your fleeting mind and you pass on not recognizing them for what they are, you will still be caught up in them, with the result that you are adding to the misery of the world. No matter whether you say you are a Christian, no matter whether you say you are a Hindu or a Mohammedan, or you follow any particular religion, or you go on your bended knees morning and night, it makes no difference. If these things are still in you, then you are not a follower of Jesus the Christ. If there is separation in any way whatsoever, you are not a follower of Jesus the Christ, and never can be, so you can get up from your knees and stop praying altogether because it does not do you one bit of good. It is all hypocrisy. Not until the deeper layer of our consciousness is brought into action can we free ourselves from this unwanted destruction. Neither can we free ourselves from disease in one until we begin to realize the inner reality that is universal, all-powerful, free, unlimited, and eternal. Therefore, what we have to do is to watch every response, every stimulation to nationalism or to any other hindrances. Each response must be thought out widely and deeply, with our inner knowledge dissolving away that which is a hindrance to our health, happiness, and perfect abundance in unity with all peoples upon earth. You are a nation unto all nations, or a people unto all peoples. These are the followers of Jesus Christ, the truth. When all these hindrances, conflicts, and sorrow are deeply and wholly understood, they are dissolved away because they are not of the perfect life that the Master spoke of and which we are trying to understand. This is the hidden law awaiting true expression in mankind. What I have in mind to do is to reveal the teachings of the Master as a true guidance for us in this 20th century. The New Testament contains all the teachings of the Master, which consists of 27 separate books, which include the four Gospels: Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. The first three Gospels cover much of the same ground, but the fourth, with quite a different feeling, stands out by itself. It is said that Matthew wrote his gospel for the Jews in the Hebrew language. Street Mark was the companion and secretary to Street Peter and had composed his gospel from the oral teachings of Street Peter. It is said that Street Mark's work is molded upon the teachings of Street Peter, which shows the salvation of all nations through the teachings of the Master Jesus, the uniting of all peoples throughout the world through the teachings of the Master Jesus. But what has happened to the teachings of the Master Jesus? They have created cults and divisions. They have put Jesus up as an idol to worship, and they have not taken into consideration even one word that he expressed, which is the greatest thing in the world. As he was asked by the Pharisees, "What is the greatest commandment?" He said, "Love the Lord thy God with all thy strength, with all thy might, with all thy heart, with all thy mind. And then the second like unto it, love your neighbor as yourself." The laws of the prophets all stand on that. The Gospel of St. John was the fourth gospel and was written in Ephesus and is universally accepted as the work of the disciple whom Jesus loved. Therefore, the Gospel of St. John gives a deeper picture of the Master's words and works while on earth. Much criticism has been hurled at the actual text of the work in these four gospels, but even so, those who have a knowledge of the mind of the Master can readily see what he meant. There is also a heated controversy over the original authorship, composition, date, and the historical character of these several writings. This we are not concerned with. What we are concerned with is the truth as it applies to ourselves and the world today. I could labor through all these textual criticisms, but it would avail nothing. What I want to show is the inspiration in these Gospels. What use would it do for me to take all these various criticisms, the controversy that is raging over the authorship and composition and date and historical character of these writings? What use at all is that too? Anybody, those intellectuals that think they know something, are like the individual who looks for a needle in a haystack and cannot get it. We are after the truth. The truth is more important to us, to you and to me, and to everyone in the world, much more important than whether the authorship and the date and historical character is correct. In every inspired work there are two elements, the human and the divine. The difference in the inspiration depends upon the prominence of one or the other of these elements. The words of the Master, when understood, reveal a higher state of inspiration than any of the other prophets. Jesus took up the work where Moses left off and expanded Moses' initial conception of a people founded upon the recognition of the unity of God into a conception of a people founded upon the recognition of the unity of man as an expression of the unity of God. This is the nucleus of the fatherhood of God and the brotherhood of man. Moses no doubt had it in his mind the true conception of the unity of man as the true expression of the Father God. So he spoke about the prophet to come that would be like unto himself. for he knew that as the human race unfolded, it should be led along the path towards its goal. As all great seers of all ages, Moses foresaw what would happen as he looked down the ages, for God had made all things plain to him. Therefore he knew that a great prophet like unto himself would come forth to lead the people of the world into the truth that would set them free. Jesus must have known Moses and Elijah, for he would not have recognized them on the mount when he took three of his disciples with him to converse with them. He must have also been told before about his mission, for Moses and Elijah were his spiritual guides. This is nothing new to us who know about spiritual communication. I myself have had such guidance, although many may not believe me. Neither would they have believed Jesus if he had told the people of his time. In fact, they were much less informed than we are today about spirit communication. It was only the most advanced seers that knew the great spiritual communication between man and the inner world, where God also dwells, as well in the same life, in the inner as in the outer. It is not very long ago in our Spanish Inquisition when people were burnt at the stake for revealing spiritual gifts. And who burnt them at the stake? The church, of course, burnt the people at the stake. That is who burnt them. The church, who was supposed to be the ideal as a means of expression of the master's teachings, burnt people at the stake and destroyed them. Is this not diabolical, that a person can be caught up in such a belief in separation that he can destroy his brother for a belief? This is why I am sure that Jesus knew that he was the prophet Moses spoke of, and when we begin to understand Moses, we begin to really understand the words of Jesus. And Jesus knew that he was the prophet because he must have spoken to Elijah and Moses long before he went up to the mount to speak to them again, to bring his disciples up so that they could also see with their own eyes that inner world of reality, the world in which the soul dwells. I am not of this world, I am of a greater world. In Luke 4:24, Jesus said, "Verily, I say unto you, no prophet is accepted in his own country," meaning, "I am like the other prophets, for I am rejected in my own country and am obliged to give my blessings to strangers." What Jesus conveyed in his own words is just what scientists have explained to us today. The physical scientist's explanation of ether corresponds to the substance which the master called water. Physicists recently have given to the world the explanation of that substance which pervades throughout the whole universe, known as ether, which is the basis of matter and the framework in which matter is built. This explanation of this substance corresponds with what the master said in regard to it when he called it water, that movable substance in which everything can move, because the word ether was not invented then. Unless you are born this time of spirit and water, you shall never enter the kingdom of heaven. Unless you understand that you are born of spirit and there is a substance more subtle than material things, then you will die in your ignorance. The movement of the divine will within will enable man to reach a height not yet even contemplated today. John 13:34-36, "I give you a new command, to love one another, as I have loved you, you are to love one another. By this everyone will recognize that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another." You can only love one another really when there is no division, where there is no high, no low, no king, no tramp, no high society, middle society, low society. Don't you see how stupid these things are? And I have read this so often. I have studied it so often, and I know that it is true. "I give you a new command to love one another as I have loved you, you are to love one another. By this everyone will recognize that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another." Benediction. O divine broadcaster, thy wisdom is searching the ether for hearts attuned to thee. The kingdom of man's mind has been clogged with illusion and has not yet heard thy call. Yet the downpour of thy love will wash away the embitterment of race, color, and class prejudices. And in thy everlasting pool of wisdom and understanding we will bathe and there wash our ignorance and cruelty away. And over the dark paths that we have trod, carpet them with thy love's roses, so that those who follow will inhale thy fragrance as they tread, pointing the way to thy palace of peace and freedom, O divine one.